Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Rabbit Who Lived by Nelson Chereta, narrated by Gary Furlong. Chapter 1. A New Day. It turned out a barge was not a pleasant way to travel. There were no cabins. The captain and his crew slept on hammocks in the hold alongside their wheat. Bell had set up one of their tents right on the deck. This made a limited area even more cramped, but gave the three of them a bare minimum of privacy. Waldo could cover the length of their boat with 20 steps. If all that weren't enough, the way the boat would sometimes rise and fall made his stomach turn. No, it was not a pleasant way to travel. But Waldo didn't care. The only thing that mattered to him was that the barge kept going downriver all through the night. There was a decent breeze, and Waldo added the little bit of wind magic he could muster to help keep the square sail billowing. Every hour took him further away from Torikai and her. The buzzing in the back of his head faded until it got to the point he could almost ignore it. He knew it would never go away completely. If he made it to the other side of the world, he would still be able to shut his eyes and point in her direction. He'd read once that when wolves were caught in traps, they would gnaw off their own legs to escape. He'd have cheerfully had Bell tear off an arm or leg if it meant he could be free of this snare. But escaping a death seal was not so easy. I suppose I could have Bell rip the heart out of my chest, Waldo thought. That might do it. He didn't sleep that night. When Alice and Bell were both slumbering, he went out to the railing of the ship and stared up at the night sky. There was a half moon out, red and angry as always, and the stars were clear and bright. The stars were the souls of the gods. So many gods. And the vast majority did not give a damn about this world or the problems of the people in it. And the ones who did notice weren't always kind. As he looked up, he wondered if just one of those pinpricks of light might be a giant rabbit. When he finally went back to his blankets, he found Alice awake. She curled up next to him, her hand resting on his shoulder. She'd asked if he was all right and what had happened back in Torikai. He didn't tell her, instead insisting everything was fine. Lying to her was sort of pointless. Through the contract's bond, they could sense each other's strong emotions, so she damn well knew something was wrong. He would need to explain things to her and Bell at some point, to tell them exactly how deeply he'd buried himself. Alice didn't push too hard and eventually fell asleep with her arms wrapped about him. For once, though, she was not crushing the life from him. Bell was lying next to them with no cover, not bothered by the cold night air. He took a moment to look at Alice's sleeping face. She was beautiful. More beautiful than Mother or Gwen or any sex slave had ever laid eyes on. That was not a surprise given Alice was a succubus. Succubi were lust incarnate, their bodies literally made to attract men. And this spectacular, one-of-a-kind beauty loved him. Genuinely loved him. Not because of a spell or a potion, but simply because. It was an odd thought, but he found it comforting. Waldo caressed her cheek with a single finger. She didn't stir. Growing up in Castle Corpse Lover, he loved his mother and his sister Gwendolyn, and no one else. With Mother, there'd been little open affection. Gwen had been the only one to ever come out and freely show him warmth. The slaves were always eager to play up to him, but they didn't count. For Waldo, love had always been a rare and wondrous thing. He pulled her a little closer and enjoyed the feel of her soft body pressed against his own. The steady rhythm of her breath finally let him fall asleep. When the horrible ball of fire was just rising above the horizon, he heard a faint whisper of a woman's voice.
"Waldo, my love, will you come and talk to me?"
It wasn't Alice who'd spoken, but her.
"No," Waldo said.
His reply terminated the spell, and the faint thread of mana snapped and faded into oblivion. Waldo didn't doubt she would try again. There was no chance she would ever let him go. Love could be both wonderful and terrifying. Alice stirred awake and opened eyes that were the color of amethyst.
"Good morning, darling."
"Good morning, Alice." He placed a soft kiss on her lips. He supposed it was as good a time as any to tell her and Belle the truth about their situation. Melissa let out a frustrated sigh.
"Why must you make this so hard?"
She wasn't surprised Waldo refused to speak to her. He'd run away after all.
Through their connection, she could sense he was already a good distance and getting further away every moment. When he'd left, he must have taken a ship. Is he planning to go all the way to the Storm Sea? She wondered. How could he still not understand that running away was pointless? The one we must follow had chosen him to do great things, and he would do them. To challenge the divine will would only lead to suffering. Why couldn't Waldo understand that? Why did he have to be so damn defiant? Melissa shut her eyes and took a deep breath. Perhaps it wasn't entirely his fault. He was still ignorant about the Order of Mist and about the god they served. She'd assumed once they'd placed the seal on him, he'd accept his fate. That she'd have plenty of time to instruct him on what it meant to be a true white mage. The journey to Avalon would be long, and she would have weeks to teach him the greater mysteries. Melissa was sure that once he accepted the truth within his heart, things would be fine. Waldo was obviously not unintelligent. She was sure with a little time and effort, she could make him understand. But events had overwhelmed her, and she'd had no choice but to let him go. Waldo really was like some force of nature bringing ruin wherever he went. He'd caused the city of Norwich to be sacked by an undead horde, and for the kingdom of Torikai to be overthrown by a religious uprising. In between, he'd started at least a dozen rumors about the Order that would cause trouble, and he seemed to produce all this chaos without even making any effort. He'd created a new religion with thousands of fanatical followers because he was bored. The way Waldo brought discord and change wherever he went reminded her of a character from legend and myth. But is he supposed to be the hero or the villain of the story? She looked out the window of her room, down at the ruins of the inner city. About 9/10 of the buildings were now charred and blackened ash. The remainder still had their illusions and were as colorful and ostentatious as they'd always been. Seeing them beside the wreckage was jarring and rather ridiculous. As she watched, a unicorn with a flowing mane dashed out between alleys. The gold wall also looked mostly the same, but here and there were large sections of gray stone where fire had obliterated the magical seals. Melissa had already decided to remove every last illusion in Torikai. She would strip away all the remnants from the past and help the people here build a future based on reality, even if that reality was ugly. She would banish every remnant of the decadent and sinful past. Looking down at all the debris, Melissa couldn't help but smile. Waldo had caused all this, brought death and destruction to this vile city, and in doing so saved thousands from starvation and led Torikai and 9 other nations into the Alliance. No, there could be no doubts. Waldo was already doing their god's work. He was the hero of this story, and with her help, he could do even greater things. She shut her eyes and bowed her head. Thy will be done. As Waldo did every morning, he placed protective wards on himself, Alice, and Belle. He did this in their tent as the crew went about their work. Waldo opened his robes, removed his shirt, and drew the runes on his chest with his index finger. They would block any attempt to use scrying or other location magic on him, and they would give him protection from magical attack. Making a combination ward like this automatically made the effects weaker than they would have been had the ward possessed a single purpose. But they would be strong enough. When it was complete, he poured some of his mana into the ward, activating it. He was now protected for another day. When that was done, he moved on to Alice. She undid the top of her dress and lowered it. "Please hurry," Alice muttered. Her face was red and she kept both hands clamped over her ample breasts. "You've nothing to be embarrassed about," Waldo told her. "Every inch of your body is magnificent. You're so beautiful, in fact, I'm sure men would be happy to pay just to look at you."
"That's right, sweetie," Belle said, "though you can't compare to me."
Belle's appearance was an illusion that made her look like a scarred barbarian.
"You could even afford to show off your boobies some more. Give all the boys a little treat."
"Shut up," Alice snapped. Her face got even redder. How did I end up with the only modest succubus in the entire world? Waldo wondered. The moment he finished, Alice pulled her dress back up and cinched it tight. Waldo moved on to Belle, who removed her armor without complaint. Belle wasn't actually wearing anything but a burlap loincloth. Her clothing and human appearance were all an illusion. Belle was a male ogre named Gronk. Before Waldo even drew the runes, he quietly recast the illusion. Spells and seals placed on inanimate objects were permanent, Anything cast on a living being had a duration of 1 day. When Waldo finished and Belle had gone through the motions of putting her armor back on, he finally told them what had happened last night.
"So, let me see if I understand this." Alice slowly rubbed at her temples. "Melissa put a spell on you that connects you two?"
"That's right," Waldo said with a despondent sigh.
"So, you're sort of her familiar?"
Belle asked with her usual lisp.
"No, dark powers be praised. She and I are both human, and you can't make a familiar of someone of the same race. If I were her familiar, I'm sure she'd have already summoned me, and she'd be able to order me to do anything she wanted."
"As bad as things are, they're at least not that horrible."
"So what exactly can she do?" Alice asked. "She can find me no matter where I am. It's the same way our contract lets me always know exactly where you two are. The reverse is true. I can tell what direction she is and how far." Waldo closed his eyes as a slight shudder ran through him.
"Well, at least there's no way she can sneak up on you."
Alice stopped rubbing her temples and nodded.
"If she has any sense, she'll just leave you alone. But that's probably too much to hope for. Don't worry, darling. If she comes for you, we'll just have to kill her."
"Right." Belle cracked her knuckles. "I'll snap her in half and gobble her up in 2 bites. No problem at all, master."
"We can't kill her."
Alice's eyes narrowed.
"Why's that?"
"Don't tell me you have feelings for her. This spell hasn't made you fall in love with her, has it?"
Waldo blanched.
"I'd sooner fall in love with a rabid wolf."
"Then what's the problem? You know I don't like killing, but I can make an exception in her case."
Waldo took a deep breath, then quickly opened his robe and pulled up his shirt. He pointed to a mark on his chest above his heart. "This is why." Alice and Belle peered in to get a good look. It was a black circle about as large as the tip of a pinky.
"What's that? A mole?"
Waldo dropped his shirt and buttoned up his robe. "It's the mark of the death seal Melissa placed on me. It means my life is bound to hers. If she dies, the mark will vanish, and my heart will burst."
"You mean like the seal you put on Kleptus?" Alice asked.
He nodded.
"But that was fake."
"Yes, but this one is real. My life is now permanently bound to Melissa's. A death seal cannot be removed or dispelled once placed, even if the caster wishes it. If Melissa dies, I die."
"So, what you're telling me," Alice said in a slow and deliberate voice, "is that a crazy woman who is in love with you because of one of your stupid potions can track you down no matter where in the world we go, and that if she attacks us, we can't kill her."
"That does pretty much sum it up."
Waldo hung his head.
"Now you can understand why I've been feeling depressed."
Alice rubbed her temples again.
"It could be worth," Belle said.
"How?"
Alice boomed, rounding on her.
"It could have given him a rash, or made him impotent or something."
Alice buried her head in her hands and half muffled a scream.
"So, what do we do now?"
Belle asked, ignoring Alice's cries.
"There is nothing to do but to keep moving forward. So far, at least, she isn't trying to follow me, and unless she kills herself, there isn't anything she can do to interfere with me."
Waldo reached into a pocket and drew out the map Valeria had given him and unfolded it. He spread it out on the ship's deck in front of them. "We'll take this boat to Kosenberg at the mouth of the Acushnet River. There we'll book passage on a ship to get us all the way to the eastern end of the Storm Sea." As he spoke, his finger traced where they would go on the map. "Then we'll just go south from there until we reach our destination, where we can search for the dragon's lair." His finger came to a stop at the tiny image of a dragon and the city beside it. Alice and Belle were both looking closely at the map.
Darling, I don't know much about the Storm Sea, but isn't it filled with Northmen raiders and pirates and sea monsters? And aren't the worst storms always in the wintertime?"
Waldo nodded. "Yes, I believe that's accurate." Alice tugged on her hair.
"I'm guessing there's no way we're waiting until spring.
I don't know how long I have until Melissa begins chasing after me. Regardless of the dangers, I want to get us as far away from her as possible."
"Well, no argument there," Alice muttered.
"Master," Belle said, "I'm no good with maps, but this looks like a long way."
"It is. Waldo pointed to the upside-down Vs that were at the edge of the map. Those are the Titanus Mountains that mark the border between the Shattered Lands and Ostagrad. Where we are going is literally the boundary of the known world. Well, that explains the name of the city, at least, Alice said. Underneath the dragon were the words, World's End.
You gotta admit, sweetie, Belle said with a grin. It seems about right. Where else would Master take us to get away from that bitch?
Alice sighed and tugged at her hair some more. Chapter 2. The End of the World. It was freezing. The weather had been chilly for a while now, but it was especially bad now. Alice was lying in blankets and most of her was warm, but the chill got her arms and face. She was just waking up and realizing Waldo was not sleeping next to her. There was something wrong. Through the bond, she could sense... Waldo let out a blood-curdling scream. Alice bolted upright, now suddenly awake. She wasn't the only one. On the other side of the tent, Belle was also throwing off blankets and rising. Through the bond, Alice could sense terror, a bone-deep fear. It was what she'd felt in Torikai when he'd been ambushed by Melissa. It was what she'd felt when Waldo's grandfather, the Lich, had almost killed him. Feeling that and hearing his scream, she didn't hesitate. Alice tossed aside the blankets and ran out the flap of the tent, wearing only her small clothes. Belle was right behind her. The sailors were out on deck, staring at Waldo in shock. When she appeared, some of them stared at her. Her legs, tummy, arms, and shoulders were on open display. Under normal circumstances, this would have embarrassed her to her core. Now she didn't even notice. All her focus was on Waldo. He was just standing by the ship's railing, staring straight up into the sky. Alice noted that the sky was overcast and a light snow was coming down. Scanning the heavens, though, she could not spot any obvious threat. What had he seen? A dragon? A wyvern? A rock? A much worse possibility occurred to her. Hadn't Waldo told her Melissa could fly? As she raced to her husband's side, she desperately searched the sky but saw nothing except snow. Darling? Darling? What's wrong? What's the matter? She grabbed onto one of his arms.
You okay, Master? What is it?
Belle was on his other side. Fortunately, the illusion from yesterday was still holding. Waldo was just standing there, shaking and staring up wild-eyed. He didn't even seem to hear them.
Darling, what is it? What's happening? Is it Melissa? Is it your grandfather? Tell me!
Waldo snapped out of it and turned to her. His eyes were wide and panicked.
Can't you see it? It's the end of the world, Alice.
What? What are you talking about?
Alice again looked overhead and tried to see if there was anything above them, but all she could see was white. Belle was doing the same.
Master, I didn't see anything.
What is it, darling? Tell us.
How can you not see it? Are you blind?
Waldo grabbed a dusting of snow off the wooden rail and held it out to her.
The sky is falling. The sky is falling. It's the end of the world.
Alice stood there and blinked. The terror coming through the bond hadn't diminished, and he was obviously terrified. But what he'd just said didn't make sense.
What are you talking about?
This. This.
Waldo waved his hands all about.
The clouds are disintegrating and falling to earth. I always knew this would happen. It's the end of the world.
Alice's jaw fell open, and she stood there staring at him. Belle reached out and patted the top of Waldo's head.
You're so cute, Master.
What?
Belle ignored him and turned to Alice.
Do you want to explain, or should I?
Alice pinched the top of her nose and took a deep breath.
Darling, this is snow. When it gets cold, water freezes, and this comes down instead of rain. Haven't you ever seen snow before?
Snow?
Waldo paused and took a closer look at the flakes that were falling. She could sense the terror in the bond melting away.
That's right. Do they not have snow in your country? Do you not have winters?
We have winters. But the place I come from neighbors a series of volcanoes. The air there is always warm.
I see, Alice said. In Lothos, the winters were not usually severe. Blizzards were rare, and if a foot of snow fell in the entire winter season, that was a lot. She supposed it made sense that coming from a place further south, he wouldn't be used to snow. But even so...
Now that I think about it, I've read about snow. It's like ice, frozen water, and occurs naturally in climates where the temperatures fall below freezing.
If you already knew about it, why did you have to panic like that? I thought you were being attacked.
Waldo rubbed the back of his neck.
Sorry, he muttered. When I saw bits of cloud falling, I was too horrified to think rationally.
Wonderful.
A breeze blew, making Alice shiver. It was at that moment she remembered she was standing out in the open, half naked. She snapped her head around to spot all the sailors gazing at her.
Eek!
She covered herself as best she could and bolted back into the tent. Belle grinned over at Waldo.
You know she'll beat you up for this, right, Master?
Waldo sighed and nodded. Chapter 3 Kosenberg.
Waldo, my love, will you come and talk to me?
Waldo stood at the bow of the ship. The frozen pieces of sky were falling lightly. He managed to remain calm and resist the urge to start screaming again. He felt a bit of pride at just how brave he was. The shore on either side of the Acushnet was white. The grass, the ground, everything was buried in freezing, cold whiteness. And Alice and the others thought this was normal? Even more unbelievable, they claimed it would be like this for months. He shook his head. How could people endure something so horrifying every single year and not go mad? Surely it was an act of mass charity. As they went downstream, they passed another barge. On the other boat, they tied the sail up, and men were busy with oars slowly pushing upstream.
It's like going up or down a steep hill,
the captain said as he cautiously approached Waldo.
One way is easy and quick, the other a struggle. Now that the snows have come, we'll have to turn around quick before the whole river freezes solid and we're trapped here for the winter.
It can do that? Waldo said, stunned. I've read about ice. When water becomes cold enough, it becomes solid as stone, I believe.
Ice ain't as hard as rock, but it can be about as heavy. But yeah, in a couple weeks or so, all this'll be frozen solid.
The captain rubbed at his neck and muttered,
Never should have let your woman talk me into this.
Waldo didn't think he was supposed to hear that last bit.
We'll be in Kosenberg soon. Then you can try and book passage to wherever it is you want to go, Master Rabbit. Well, if you can find anyone willing to take you, at least.
I can afford it no matter how much it costs.
I don't doubt it. But the price ain't the problem. Winter is come.
The captain waved at all the horrifying whiteness.
And winter is the storm season. They don't call it the storm sea for nothing. Squalls and tempests can come out of nowhere all year round. But this time of year, the ocean is about as savage and cruel as a woman during her bleeding time.
That bad?
Waldo said with obvious panic. The captain nodded.
Would you be willing to take me to the eastern end of the storm sea? You've taken me this far, so why not the rest of the way? I can pay you well.
Enough for a new boat? A barge can't go out on the ocean. The draft is too shallow. She can't survive the waves in a rough sea. The same way big ships with deep hulls can't go up the river without grounding. The only ships that can do both are the longboats the Northmen use.
The only Northman Waldo had ever laid eyes on had been the one who had almost killed Belle back in Torikai. They had the reputation of being both ferocious warriors as well as expert sailors.
Maybe I can hire one then.
Good luck finding a Northman crew in Kosenberg.
The captain dipped his head and went to help a couple of his crew. Waldo assumed it was roughly noon when they arrived. He couldn't be sure as the snow had picked up and the sky was an unending stretch of white. His usual relief at not having to see the horrible ball of fire was cancelled out by the continuous fall of bits of frozen cloud. Brave Waldo held fast to his courage, though. Kosenberg was the port city in the mouth of the Acushnet. The river split in two, with buildings spread out on each bank. From his initial impression, Waldo thought it a good-sized place, though smaller than Altar, and a fraction of Torikai. There were rocky outcropping and stretches of sandy ground in the middle of the river. There were no buildings on any of them, but he counted 4 bridges with foundations on these spits of land. The bridges would span across to one isle and then all the way to the other side. Despite all the frozen water falling, Waldo noted there were people and wagons crossing each bridge as they sailed past. There were also plenty of rowboats either going up, down, or across the river. The buildings went right up to the water's edge. Each structure on the riverbank had a wooden ladder that went down into the water and led directly to a door. Some larger buildings had wooden piers where rowboats would be tied up and bobbing up and down. Despite the obvious horrors and the distressing cold, there was plenty of activity. The locals here were obviously either extremely brave or mad. Each time they passed beneath a bridge, the top of the barge's mast came within a foot or two of the wooden supports. It was obvious that bigger ships with much taller masts could not pass beneath. Before setting foot on the barge, Waldo had never had any experience with ships. He assumed the vessels big enough to go out on the ocean would look much like larger versions of the boat he was on. It would be nice if there were enough room on them to have some privacy without the need to pitch a tent. He wanted to find a ship and set sail as soon as possible. Belle and Alice came up to him and stood on either side.
"So, what happens now, Master?"
Belle asked. Through the bond, he could sense excitement. "We find someone to take us all the way to the eastern end of the Storm Sea. Then we'll head south. The map I have isn't detailed enough to show me any towns, rivers, or roads in the area. I only know the general direction of where we're headed. Once we get there, we'll figure everything else out."
"You want to leave right away?" Alice said, disappointed. "This place looks interesting. Couldn't we at least stay a couple days?"
Waldo shook his head. "According to the captain, it'll be hard to find someone willing to take us at this time of year. So, there's no time to waste. Besides, I want to get as far away as possible from Melissa before she tries to catch up."
"I suppose," Alice sighed.
Belle rolled her eyes.
"You still worried about Melissa? Come on now, Master. You know we can handle her if we need to."
"I'm sure," Waldo said. "But I'd rather not need to." The Akushnet had emptied into the ocean and brought them to the docks. It surprised Waldo to see the entire area enclosed by a 20-foot-tall stone wall. The wall encircled the bay and closed it from the sea except for one opening wide enough to allow 2 of the fattest galleys to enter side by side. On either side of the gap were matching stone towers, with massive bonfires burning atop them. Every inch of the waterfront had wooden piers stretching out into the sea. So far as Waldo could tell, multiple ships were tied up alongside to each pier. There had to be hundreds. The ships varied in size to 1-man rowboats to 50-foot-long behemoths, with 4 masts and a forest of ropes and sails. The wind was whipping, and the frozen water was hardly coming down, so Waldo could see banners flying from the top of the masts of the large ships. About a quarter of the ones he could spot were of a large blue fish on a field of white. The rest were a diverse mix of colors and shapes. There were snakes, eagles, bulls, patterns of stars, castles, hills, giants, bleeding stars, the red moon, swords, horses, and many, many more. None of them displayed 7 black skulls on a white field. Alteroth didn't have a coastline or ships. Waldo was very surprised to spot one of the galleys with a gold line on a field of blue. Venezia was among the great cities of the world and had a merchant fleet second to none. Their ships could be found in almost every port. But Venezia was in the inner sea. To be here, they would have left the inner sea, gone out the mouth, traveled up the coast of the western sea past Avalon, then most of the way through the storm sea avoiding pirates and Northmen raiders. A journey of many thousands of miles. About the only voyage he could imagine being longer and more hazardous would be traveling south around the tip of Arica, through the Kraken Straits, and going all the way to Wulan. Waldo was cheered by the thought that his trip would at least be shorter and presumably easier than that, though only the first leg would be by ship. The captain had to search a while before finding an open space at a pier. The sailors took out oars and rowed them into place. They tied up the barge, and with that, this part of his journey was now complete. As Belle gathered up their things, the captain approached Waldo.
"Well, Master Rabbit, I wish ye good fortune."
"Are you sure you wouldn't be willing to take me the rest of the way?" Waldo asked.
"More than sure. This ship ain't made for the open sea, and my crew and I are a long way from home."
He looked away and muttered,
"I ain't sure why I ever agreed to this."
Alice walked up beside her husband and offered the captain a guilty smile.
"I apologize for the trouble we caused you,
but my husband and I are both deeply grateful.
Just not as grateful as we'd be if you brought us further, Waldo said. Alice gave him a swift elbow to his ribs.
If you want to book passage, you'll need to make arrangements with the ship's captain. You'll likely find a few in every dockside tavern and whorehouse. If you're serious about leaving before spring, I wouldn't waste time if I were you.
The captain shrugged.
Not that I think it will make much difference.
It'll be fine, Waldo said. I have gold and I'm a white mage. I'm certain plenty of people will be eager to help me.
Whatever you say.
Waldo gave him a final wave and stepped off the ship and onto the pier. The blessings of unity, justice, and peace and all that. On you.
Alice was at his side. Belle followed a couple of steps behind with all their gear piled atop her back. Waldo noted that by the time they were halfway down the pier, the barge was untied and the sailors pushing her back out into the water.
Chapter 4. A Very Uncomfortable Situation. They were headed for their third tavern. There hadn't been any captains at the first two they'd visited. The barman at the second place had recommended they try a nearby whorehouse if they wanted to meet a whole bunch of ship captains. Waldo had asked for directions, but Alice had dragged him out by his collar. Despite knowing they were in a rush, she refused to let him visit such a place. Alice really could be very inconsiderate at times. It was then they were approached by a man in a white doublet with a blue fish on it. He was followed by half a dozen soldiers. They came right up to Waldo and bowed.
Welcome to Kosenberg, Master. I am Harold Beck, servant to Count Helmut Rundstedt. I assume you are the new ambassador from Avalon?
Somewhere the dark powers were definitely chuckling.
No, actually. I am just here to find a ship. I have important business elsewhere.
A ship? Beck said in surprise. But it's winter.
I've noticed. There were small piles of frozen water on the ground, and he could see his breath every time he spoke.
But I still have important work to do far from here.
The man paused and rubbed his hands together.
Is that so? Well, the Count would still want to meet with you and extend his hospitality for as long as you are here.
That really won't be necessary.
Please, Master,
I am Waldo Rabbit. This is my wife Alice Rabbit, and my servant, Belle of Tarsus.
Pleased to meet you, Alice curtsied.
Charmed, sweetie. Master Rabbit, please come with me. The Count only wishes to pay his respects and discuss a few matters with you. You've only arrived. Surely you would like a hot meal and a warm bed for the night? I beg you to accept the Count's hospitality.
After his experience with Queen Mattis, the last thing Waldo wanted was to be a guest in a castle. The guards were standing there shivering and looking bored. They were no threat, but would slaughtering a bunch of guards and a Count's servant cause problems?
Probably. Fine, but please make sure your Count understands it's only for today. My work is urgent, and I can't waste time.
I understand, he answered with a relieved smile. If you would come with me.
He led them to a small castle with two towers. Waldo estimated it was perhaps a fifth the size of Castle Corpselover. Beck took them to some rooms within the main keep. Waldo reminded him he and his companions would only stay for one night.
This is a mistake, Waldo complained when they were alone.
Is it so bad, darling? We were stuck on a ship for 5 days, and we'll be on another one for who knows how long. Is it so bad to have just one day to rest in between?
It's a day Melissa could use to start chasing us.
Didn't you say she's still in Torikai and hasn't gotten any closer since we left?
That doesn't mean I want to give her any chance to follow.
Come on, darling. It's not like I want that either. But let's just spend one night in a soft bed. That's all I ask. First thing in the morning, we'll find a ship and leave.
Fine, I suppose.
Though, if this Count tries to get me to wear cat ears and a tail, we're slipping away in the middle of the night.
They met Count Helmut Rundstedt when they sat down to dinner. He was a thin, well-manicured man with dark black hair that was just beginning to turn gray. Count Rundstedt was polite but somewhat reserved. He sat down and ate with them but said little. The meal comprised local cuisine, including the marinated pot roast called Sauerbraten, potato dumplings, loaves of rye bread, sausages, egg noodles, and fermented cabbage they called sauerkraut. Waldo avoided the cabbage, but everything else was tasty enough.
Alice enjoyed the meal as well, while Belle, shockingly, devoured 3 plates worth. When dinner was over, the Count stood and motioned to Waldo.
Master Rabbit, do you think I could have a word in private with you? We can let the ladies enjoy their evening.
Waldo didn't want a private meeting with the Count. He didn't want to be there. He wanted to be on a ship somewhere out to sea. But refusing would probably be considered rude. After his experiences with Queen Mattis, he believed it would be best to be polite and avoid any entanglements or misunderstandings. So Waldo rose from his seat and nodded. I'd be delighted. Rundstedt led him to a parlor with some comfortable chairs. The Count sat down in one and waved to the seat next to his.
Please, Master Rabbit.
As Waldo sat, the Count pulled out a small pouch and a pipe of carved ivory. He stuffed the pipe with tobacco.
I use a special blend all the way from Hispana. Would you like to try some?
Waldo shook his head. I don't have the habit.
Pity. It's one of the great pleasures in life.
When he was done, he put the pouch away and reached into one of his pockets.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.